let's open our Bibles if you haven't already. We're in chapter 27, and we're coming to the end of our study in the book of Acts, and so you may be wondering where we're going to go next, and so am I, so I'll let you know when I decide, because I'm not sure yet. But we'll be looking today at the 27th chapter, and just for those of you who may be joining us today for the first time or watching online or whatever you're doing, this is a lot of material to cover. It's 44 verses, and so what I do is I'm going to be just reading some of the scriptures as I did last week. We covered two chapters. I'll be reading scriptures and then tying them in or giving you some explanation so that you get a sense of what's happening here in this passage. And it really is like a travel log for the Apostle Paul. You'll see that. And what I try to do is I try to land on certain portions and develop it a bit for you so you can have some practical application. And so we'll begin here in chapter 27 at verse 1. We'll read verses 1 through 3. I'll give your introduction. We'll move into our study. And so let's begin. Acts chapter 27, beginning at verse 1, reading to verse 3. And when it was decided that we should sail to Italy, they delivered Paul and some other prisoners to one named Julius, a centurion of the Augustan regiment. So entering a ship of Adramidium, we put to sea, meaning to sail along the coasts of Asia. Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. And the next day we landed at Sidon. Julius treated Paul kindly and gave him liberty to go to his friends and receive care. And so Paul has been in a kind of house arrest, as we've seen, and he had been in a place called Caesarea. Caesarea is a port city on the coast of central Israel and all, and he's been under a kind of house arrest for over 2 years. We've already seen how, though he was under house arrest, he's had opportunity to communicate the gospel. He had the opportunity to preach to certain government officials about the Lord Jesus Christ. He had spoken to a man by the name of Ananias. He had also spoken to one referred to as King Agrippa. That reminds me of Psalm 119, verse 46, where the psalmist said, "I will speak of your testimonies before kings, and I will not be ashamed." And so we see that in the Apostle Paul. He has the opportunity to present the message of the gospel to government officials, and he does it. So what we have here is we have a man who is faithful to his calling. This is an example, an amazing example of someone who is not hesitant to share the gospel with those who will hear. He's not reluctant to share because he knows the gospel has a tremendous worth. He knows that the message is considered by people as nonsense, as it was then, it still is today. And when he spoke to the intellectual Athenians, many of them had mocked him. When he shared with government men like Felix and Festus Agrippa, they all thought he was crazy, he was unhinged, he was beside himself. He knew that those rejecting the gospel message thought that it was imbecilic, it was moronic, nonsensical. The idea that a man would die for the sins of mankind to save them, well, in the intellectual world, that's absurdity. But he also knew of its power. He knew that the gospel had the power to bring forgiveness. He knew in the message of the gospel that the gospel has power to bring transformation. And he knew that the gospel message had the power for salvation. In 1 Corinthians 1:18, he says, "The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it's the power of God." When we talk about someone being saved, you might want to note this. The word saved can be translated rescued. It can be translated delivered or made well. And that's what the gospel is intended to do, transform us, rescue us, deliver us, to heal us. And that's what he does. He brings this message that heals us of the brokenness of our lives because of our sin and forgives us and gives us a relationship to God. And he knew that. And he knew that when someone was saved, that they would have an entirely new life. You don't give the gospel a chance. You give yourself wholly over to the message of the gospel and you're transformed by it because God does a work in you. Ezekiel tells us in chapter 36, verses 26 and 27, God made this promise. He said, "I'll give you a new heart. and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone, give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. You may have every desire to be good, to do the good things, to do the right things. You may have been taught the commandments when you're a kid and all. You want to do those, but you don't have the power to do them. The will is with you. The power to do it is not. Well, God said, I'll give you a new heart. I'll put my spirit in you. I'm going to write my word on the tablet of your heart. And so from the inside, you're going to want to do those things that are pleasing. And that comes through getting saved. That comes through coming to faith in God through Christ. That's a promise he gives us. You see, the death of Christ on the cross was God's greatest instrument of salvation. Because it was on the cross that Christ paid the penalty for my sins. It was on the cross that he died so that I might be given life. In Colossians 2:13, Paul said, when you were dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sin. So this all hinged on the resurrection of Jesus. This is what Paul is preaching. Now his enemies, many of whom believed in, at least theoretically, believed in resurrection, were rejecting that it actually had happened. And we saw that Paul had just preached to Agrippa. We also saw that Agrippa had rejected the message. When we left off our study last time, we saw that Agrippa believed that Paul was innocent. But Paul had made his appeal to Rome. And because he had done that, Agrippa has sent him to appear before the Caesar. And that's where we're picking up our story. And so it says in verse 1 of chapter 27, when it was decided that we should sail to Italy, they delivered Paul and some other prisoners to one named Julius, the centurion of the Augustan regiment. And so Paul is now traveling. He's going from Caesarea, and he's traveling now to Rome. Verse 2 says, entering a ship of Adramidium, we put to sea, meaning to sail along the coast of Asia. And then notice Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. And the next day we landed at Sidon. And Julius treated Paul kindly, gave him liberty to go to his friends and receive care. And so he's traveling from Caesarea. He's on his way to Rome. He's going to be tried before the imperial court. Now earlier he had been stating that he wanted to go to Rome. In chapter 19, verse 21, Paul said, I'm going to Jerusalem, and after I've been there, I must also see Rome. When he wrote to the book, wrote the book of Romans, when he wrote a letter to the church of Rome, he said in chapter 1, verse 13, I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often planned to come to you, but was hindered until now, that I might have some fruit among you also, just as among other Gentiles. But he went on to verse 15 to say, so as much as in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you who are in Rome also. So his great desire was to go and to testify of the Lord Jesus Christ in Rome. And so now he's on his way, but he's going as a prisoner on his way to trial. This isn't something that he was unaware of. The Spirit had prepared him in Acts 20, verse 23. He had said, the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. So he's gotten his wish, his desire is being fulfilled. He's on his way to Rome. Now, I'll just do a little aside here. I want you to notice something in verse 1. Notice how Luke includes himself in this. Notice how he said, when we had departed. Last time we've seen Luke mentioned was in chapter 21, verse 18, which was 2 years before. That was when they were in Jerusalem and Paul had told James how God had moved amongst the Gentiles. And it was at that time that Paul had been arrested and was held in custody. So Luke now reconnects with Paul and Paul is being taken to Rome. And so Paul, with other prisoners who had appealed to Caesar, is on his way to Rome. Now notice again that they're under the custody of Julius of the Augustan regiment. So this man, Julius, is somebody who is a soldier. He leads other soldiers, and they were assigned to the bodyguards of Caesar. They enter into a ship, verse 2. It's called a ship of Adramidium, which was in Turkey, northwest Turkey. And they sailed off. So they're going from northwest, from Caesarea. They stop in a place called Sidon, which is 70 miles north, and they continue going north. It's what we're seeing here, and I'll just be touching it a bit, is a nonstop narrative or a stop-by-stop narrative of their journey. Now, I want you to notice again as I'm laying a foundation in verse 3, how it says, the next day we landed at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and gave him liberty to go to his friends and receive care. Now, Paul is on his way. He's going with other prisoners. I forgot to mention Aristarchus. Aristarchus is mentioned in Scripture more than once. He's a traveling companion of the Apostle Paul. And so he's a friend, he's a fellow minister, and as a loyal friend, he's undergoing hardship with him, and he's traveling with him. But it points out in verse 3 that they landed Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly. So we know through history that what he did is he gave him an orange Julius. It was amazing, he loved it, and he developed a franchise all through the world. I love orange Juliuses. No, he treated him kindly. What does that mean? What it means is he gave him, like it says in verse 3, he gave him liberty. He let him go free for a while. Where did he go? He went to his friends. I want to point something out here. He went to his friends, and he received care. So Paul is visiting a church that met in Sidon, and it's these brothers and sisters that are providing him with provisions. Now, that's something we often see in Scripture. From the very beginning, when the church was first birthed, there were financial needs. So what happened was the church united to care for the needs of fellow believers. When we started our study in Acts chapter 2, verses 44 and 45, it said, all who believed were together, had all things in common, sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all as anyone had need. So from the very beginning, they practiced charity, loving one another. It wasn't invented by Christianity. There are commands in the Old Testament to care for those in need. They just continued to follow through with the Scripture and the command to care for those who are lovers of the Lord. When the church was in Jerusalem and it was in need, different churches came to their aid. Paul speaks of that in Romans 15, verse 26, when he says, it pleased those from Macedonia and Achaia, which speaks of ancient Greece, to make certain contribution for the poor among the saints who are in Jerusalem. When Paul was in need in a personal way, the Philippian church provided for him. In Philippians 4:15, it says, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you only. And then finally, these believers ministered to his needs because that's what Christians do. In 3 John verses 5 through 8, it reads, beloved, you are faithful in what you're doing for the brothers, even though they are strangers to you. They have told the church about your love. You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. They sent forth for his name's sake, receiving no help from the pagans. We ought therefore to show hospitality to such men so that we may work together for the truth. So this is what they're doing. He says in verse 3 that Julius treated Paul kindly, gave him liberty to go to his friends, and received care. So they took care of his necessities. Verse 4, when we had put to sea from there, we sailed under the shelter of Cyprus because the winds were contrary. And when we had sailed over the sea, which is off Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra, a city of Lycia. There, the centurion found an Alexandrian ship sailing to Italy, and he put us on board. When we had sailed slowly many days and arrived with difficulty off Cnidus, the wind not permitting us to proceed, we sailed under the shelter of Crete off Salmon. Passing with difficulty, we came to a place called Fair Havens near the city of Ontario. And so we have a lot of cities that don't mean anything to us. It's just giving to us some insight into the direction. They're traveling against headwinds. And because they're going slowly, this is the point he's making, they had to come to a port called Fair Havens. This was a bay in Crete. And it's called Fair Havens because it's a good harbor. And so verse 9, when much time had been spent and sailing was now dangerous because the fast was already over, Paul advised them, saying, "Men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only of the cargo and ship, but also our lives." Nevertheless, the centurion was more persuaded by the helmsman and the owner of the ship than by the things spoken by Paul. And because the harbor was not suitable to winter in, the majority advised to set sail from there also, if by any means they could reach Phoenix, a harbor of Crete, opening toward the southwest and northwest, and winter there. Let me give you a little bit of insight into what's taking place here. It speaks of being much time having been spent, and sailing is dangerous. And he says, because of the fast. When he says, because of the fast, he's giving to us a timeline. This speaks of the Day of Atonement. This would tell us this took place in late September or early October. So travel's dangerous from mid-September to mid-November, and travel would completely cease from November to February. So the point he's making is very simple. They're moving into the dangerous season for sailing. Now, as this is taking place, notice in verse 10 how he says, "Men, I perceive that this voyage will end with disaster and much loss, not only for the cargo and ship, but also our lives." Paul's travel experience, as well as the Holy Spirit, is moving him to warn them not to go. Now, understandably, the centurion was much more open to the experience of the sailors. He took consideration related to the lack of comfort at the port, but they decided to follow the experience of the sailors. Again, that's very understandable. Why would we listen to someone with little or no experience? Remember when the Apostle Peter was spoken to by the Lord Jesus Christ, who had said to him, while they were there on the shoreline of the Sea of Galilee, "Cast out your ship, drop your nets in the deep, and you'll get a catch of fish." Do you remember how the Apostle Peter began to argue with Christ? And he said, "Master, we've been toiling all night, and we've caught nothing." Now, why would you say we've been toiling all night? Well, because they were net fishermen, and it doesn't make sense in the daylight to drop a net because the fish will see it. So we've been toiling all night, and we've caught nothing. "Master, we are fishermen. That's our business. That's what we do. That's how we make money. You're a person who is a carpenter. You're a mason, and you work with wood. And you're now a preacher. So you have a different field of expertise. I've been fishing since I was young, and you have never been a fisherman. So if you don't mind, let me share with you my expertise and awaken you to the fact that you really don't know anything about fishing. And so we've been doing this all night, I want you to know. But nevertheless, at your word, we'll drop the net." And that's what they did. And we know the story. We know how the net went down, and then they pulled it up. And if you can imagine the excitement that took place, and if you can picture for a moment in your mind's eye, the Apostle Peter, who would have been amazed, and here they're drawing in this net filled with fish, and they're just so excited, and you can see his face. And then he turns and he looks at Christ. It's like that smile, it melts from his face. It melts for a moment. Because he realizes, this isn't supposed to happen. I gave the master a lecture concerning how to go about doing his work. And that's when Peter looks at Jesus and says to him, "Depart from me. I'm a sinful man." We have a tendency of relying on our own expertise or the expertise of others to the degree that when a warning could be given to us that you have to be careful about this, the first thing that people do is they will argue with you saying, what do you know? Is that your profession? We know that for a fact, don't we? We know that. COVID comes. We all went through it. And we were told to do things like put on a mask, stay 6 feet away. And we all, because who knows what's going on, we have to trust the experts. I have no contention against doing what is wise. We did that here in the church. We don't know. We have to get the information. We have to make a decision. We have to have more. We don't know what's going on. So, you know, I wanted to err on the side of caution. And that's what we did. We need to gather more information. But then slowly but surely we hear, well, who created this 6-foot distancing? Where'd that come from? And then men like Fauci and all who are looked at as prophetic, they're saying, well, we just can't, you know, you mean you have no scientific reason for that? No, we just thought it was the best thing to do. And we're all running around driving in a car by ourselves with masks on? Experts said it. Oh, now we're being told, oh, no, you have to drive electric vehicles and we're going to shut down all the gas industry and all of that, even though it's totally impractical. But we're going to save the planet. Really? Tell that to China. Tell that to India. Tell that to the greatest polluters on the face of the earth and see what they do. Well, they're building up all of their armament and all. You have people telling, no, the experts said to do that, right? That's how it works. Oh, the planet is melting. It's melting. It's going to melt within 12 years, we were told 9 years ago. When I was in college, it wasn't melting. It was freezing. So I have a healthy rejection of someone just because they're called an expert. I have a healthy rejection of that. Oh, you know, if your kid says that he's a girl, then you need to let him be a girl and go through this terrible surgery or give him puberty blockers because he feels like he's a girl. Yeah, well, I raised kids, and my son David thought he was Superman. I threw him off the roof, and he discovered he's not. I mean, every parent knows that, don't we? We know that. We know that. And yet the experts are telling you, mutilate your children, give them puberty blockers. We can go on about this. These are just thoughts that I had just before I came up to teach this morning. Because the world has a tendency of accumulating the experts that seem to fit most with their philosophy of life. And that's kind of what we saw. And we're still seeing it now. It's a form of controlling you, forcing you to do what somebody else tells you to do. And the funny thing about it is the older people like myself who were raised in a different generation are saying, I don't believe a word you're saying, but I'm going to investigate for myself. Where a younger generation who's glued to a screen constantly being told this is what you're supposed to think is thinking differently because they don't have any capacity to reason through, because our universities are filled with people who are brainwashing our children. I'm not making this up. I'm not a paranoid. I'm just telling you the truth. That's what's taking place. So most dangerous place for your 18-year-old is college today, because some of the people that I've known, even kids who were raised in this church, are out there marching for Palestine and saying, you know, free Palestine. But wait a minute, you're uninformed in what's taking place. I've been to Israel 30 times. I think I've seen some things that you haven't seen. Oh no, it's just, so it's the experts. We have to be wise. And it takes the Holy Spirit. And in the case of Paul, these are expert sailors. But in the case of Paul, the Holy Spirit is giving to him a forewarning, and he's telling them, this is what's going to take place. But because the world is the world, and I get it, the world is the world, they have a tendency of listening to those whom they deem to be expert. And that's what's happening here. This is going on right here. And so the world has a tendency of listening to its experts, but not listening when the voice of reason and spirit is speaking. And so verse 12 says, because softly, supposing that they had obtained their desire. Putting out to sea, they sailed close by Crete. But not long after, a tempestuous headwind arose called Euroclydon. So when the ship was caught and could not head into the wind, we let her drive. And running under the shelter of an island called Clauda, we secured the skiff with difficulty. And so the sea seemed calm enough to set out, and they began to follow along the coast. As they are sailing, they encounter a typhoon. It's called Euroclydon. The word Euroclydon speaks of wind waves. So it speaks of a powerful storm that they encounter, and that's what's happening at that moment. So in verse 15, when the ship was caught and could not head into the wind, we let her drive. Running under the shelter of an island called Clauda, we secured the skiff with difficulty. And when they had taken it on board, they used cables to undergird the ship, fearing lest they should run aground on the Syrtis sands. They struck sail and so were driven. And so the ship couldn't keep course. They yielded to the wind. They were driven to an island 23 miles south on the western coast of Crete. They lifted the skiff, the small boat, into the ship. They undergirded the ship with cables, and they're fearing that they're going to run aground on what is called the shifting sands and be lost. So there's this terror that's going on. You have to have a picture of that. The storm is driving the ship, and they're afraid. Verse 18, and because we were exceedingly tempest-tossed, the next day they lightened the ship. And on the third day, we threw the ship's tackle overboard with our own hands. Now, when neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and no small tempest beat on us, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. So you have to picture the storm, all that's going on, the constant motion, everything that's taking place. And they're tossing over the tackle. That means the beds, the luggage, tables, everything. And the sun isn't shining. Remember in verse 20 that sailors navigated through the sun and the stars, but the ship was moving, but they don't know where. And at that point, they're giving up. It says in verse 20, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. Verse 21, but after long abstinence from food, then Paul stood in the midst of them and said, men, you should have listened to me and not have sailed from Crete and incurred this disaster and loss. And now I urge you to take heart, for there will be no loss of life among you, but only of the ship. For there stood by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve, saying, do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar. And indeed, God has granted you all those who sail with you. Therefore, take heart, men. For I believe God that it will be just as it was told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island. And so I want you to note this. In verse 21, all hope that we would be saved was finally given up. All their efforts, all their sailing experience could not save them. Picture it for a moment. The sea is tossing. Salt spray is stinging their faces. Their backs are strained. Their arms and legs are cramping. The wind is making the boat rock so violently they can hardly stand, let alone walk. And after 3 days, they're fatigued and they're seasick. They haven't eaten because of nausea. They can't prepare meals in the storm. They have completely given up. And all that is awaiting them is death. Now, after verse 21, after the long abstinence from food, notice Paul. Paul stood up in the midst of them and said, men, you should have listened to me. We all have had friends like that. I told you. Oh, somebody slapped Paul. I mean, people, even though you didn't listen, so he lets them know, even though you didn't listen, still do not fear. Why wouldn't I fear? Well, God has revealed to me that he's taking care of me. I want to develop something with you here. God has revealed to me that he is taking care of me, and God will take care of you also. Let me give you a principle. This is something that I believe is very important and something I hope you take out with you today. When God is blessing someone, Very often, others may be blessed along with them. When God is blessing someone, very often, I'll give you examples, someone else may be blessed along with them. In the Old Testament, Joseph, the son of Jacob, had been sold into slavery in Egypt. And Joseph had been bought by an Egyptian official named Potiphar. In Genesis 39, verses 2 through 5, it says, "The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. From the time he put him in charge of his household and of all that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both in the house and in the field." When the Lord was blessing Joseph, Potiphar was getting the overflow of the blessing. The blessing of the Lord was on Joseph, but the blessing of the Lord was also on Potiphar. When God is blessing you, there will be an overflow very often upon others that may not even be part of the family of God. You may be working on in some flow over to the owner, the boss or whatever of that particular company that you're working for. It's a principle where God blesses his believing ones and it can flow over it. That's found in marriage also. Two people get married. One of them gets saved. And when the marriage partner gets saved, God begins to bless that the Christian. And that overflow of blessing to the Christian is going to flow into the family. That would be like an unsaved wife or unsaved husband, but they're married to a believer. And in 1 Corinthians 7:14, Paul said, "The unbelieving husband has been sanctified through his wife. The unbelieving wife has been sanctified through her believing husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but as it is, they are holy." What does that mean? It says that the children have the opportunity to come to faith in Christ because of a believer in the house, and God will bless the house because of the believer, and even include to bless the children. Nations are blessed through the blessing that God gives to his people. Once again, looking at Joseph as an example. In Genesis 41, Joseph interpreted a dream that the Pharaoh had had. It was a dream predicting 7 years of abundance followed by 7 years of famine. And so Joseph instructed Pharaoh to save 1/5 of the produce from the 7 years of plenty. So that gave Egypt an abundance of supplies for the 7 years that followed of famine. And there was so much grain that Egypt had that the surrounding nations were able to survive because God had blessed through Joseph the nation. Now, Billy Graham once said this: "America has probably been the most successful experiment in history. The American dream was a glorious attempt. Its success was because it was built on the faith of our forefathers who believed in Almighty God to guide them. The early concepts of America came from Holy Scripture, and the Lord blessed us because of it." And so there's a reason why this nation has yet to go down, because the Lord is still taking care of his children. And I just really believe that we need to become more awake at this time and encourage others to come to the faith of Christ in the way that God has cared for us so that this nation can be revived and awakened. And so as this is taking place, Paul is saying, you're not going to die. You're going to lose the ship, but your lives will be spared. You see, Paul and Aristarchus were cared for, and so were the others. Now in verse 23, it says, "There stood by me this night an angel of the God to whom I belong and to whom I serve, saying, 'Do not be afraid, Paul. You must be brought before Caesar. Indeed, God has granted you all those who sail with you.'" So the angel was sent by the Lord Now notice it's the God that he preaches and the God that he worships. In verse 24, don't be afraid. You must be brought before Caesar. So God is saying, Paul is saying really, but God is not finished with Paul. He's going to graciously grant these men life also. So in verse 25, he says, therefore take heart, men, for I believe God that it will be just as it was told me. However, we must run aground on a certain island. So I trust the Lord to be faithful and true to his word. In Numbers 23:19, it says, God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should repent. Has he said, will he not do it? Has he spoken, will he not make it good? So God is going to keep his word, but we're going to run aground on an island. In chapter 28, we find out that it's the island of Malta. Well, in verse 27, now, when the 14th night had come, as we were driven up and down in the Adriatic, that's the Mediterranean, about midnight, the sailors sensed that they were drawing near some land, and they took soundings and found it to be 20 fathoms. And when they had gone a little farther, they took soundings again, found it to be 15 fathoms. And fearing lest we should run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for a day to come. And so they're in the Mediterranean. They have a sense they're coming near shore. They're nearing south of Sicily, the Isle of Malta. It's 3 miles south of the bay. And notice they're wishing it was morning. Well, verse 30, the sailors were seeking to escape from the ship when they had let down the skiff into the sea under pretense of putting out anchors from the prow. Paul said to the centurion of the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. And the soldiers cut away the ropes of the skiff and let it fall off. So Paul has earned the respect of the centurion and the soldiers. He's earned their respect by his calmness, his accuracy, his wisdom. And so they're listening to him now as he's giving them advice. Verse 33, as the day was about to dawn, Paul implored them all to take food, saying, today is the 14th day. You have waited and continued without food and eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take nourishment, for this is for your survival, since not a hair will fall from the head of any of you. And when he had said these things, he took bread and gave thanks to God in the presence of them all. And when he had broken it, he began to eat. Then they were all encouraged and also took food for themselves. And in all, we were 276 persons on the ship. So when they had eaten enough, they lightened the ship and threw out the wheat into the sea. So he encourages them, eat. They haven't eaten for several days. Leading by example, he takes food, he blesses the God who saves, and he eats. And when he was doing that, he was reminding them of who it was who was in charge. It's like what it says in Psalm 107:25. He commands and raises a stormy wind which lifts up the waves of the sea. Well, we'll close by looking at 39 to the end. When it was day, they did not recognize the land. They observed a bay with a beach onto which they planned to run the ship if possible. And they let go the anchors and left them in the sea. Meanwhile, loosing the rudder ropes, and they hoisted the mainsail to the wind and made for shore. Striking a place where two seas met, they ran the ship aground, and the prow stuck fast, remained immovable, but the stern was being broken up by the violence of the waves. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners, lest any of them should swim away and escape, but the centurion, wanting to save Paul, kept them from their purpose and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest, some on boards and some on parts of the ship. And so it was that they all escaped safely to land. So let's close by looking at a few things here. They didn't know where they were. It had been stormy, it had been violent, but they see a beach. They bring the ship to the shore. Notice verse 42, the soldiers' plan is to kill the prisoners. Why is that? It's because if any of the prisoners escaped, the soldiers would be executed. But because Paul had found favor with the centurion, and the centurion wanted to save Paul, he kept them from their purpose. You see, Paul had shown his worth, so the centurion saved him. I want you to notice verse 44. This is interesting here when it says, the rest, some on boards. That is the first historic record of a surf ministry in Christianity, right there. They were in Huntington. I want to develop something and close with you right now. What we've seen, and I want to develop this, this is practical. What we see here is the leadership of the Apostle Paul in the most practical way. Paul earned the respect of the centurion. So the centurion saved Paul. This is the same kind of thing that you can do to impact people. I want you to look. First, Paul took initiative. From the beginning, he gave counsel. Second, the counsel that he gave was wise. It was sound. The third thing, as he was giving counsel, he did so with authority. As he's giving them counsel, he's encouraging those who are afraid. And he remains firm in his understanding of the leading of God. And in the midst of all of this, he's leading by example. If you want to impact people, these are things you need to mark down in your own life. Take the initiative. Give sound advice. Speak with an authority. Encourage those who are afraid. Remain firm in understanding the work of God and how God moves. And then put that into practice yourself. And what it does is it inspires people. Because when there's chaos, people are looking for the calm. They're looking for the person who remains calm, even in the midst of chaos, even in the midst of difficulty. I've shared this with you before, but I want to close with this. We were flying home from Israel. We encountered off of the eastern coast of New York a very powerful rainstorm. It was so powerful that the 747 that we were on, this huge airplane, began to vibrate. It's vibrating, and so much so that the people, as we're descending, coming into New York. By the way, we're going to Israel soon, and I'd love you to go with us. But anyway, I'm sure this will sell you on coming. So the plane is shaking like that, so much so that the masks are starting to pop out of the ceiling. People are screaming. They're crying. I remember turning around. My daughter, Corinne, and her seatmate were right behind me. And my daughter, Corinne, was like 15 at the time, and she was singing worship songs. I said, she thinks she's going to die. She didn't do that. And she's singing. And I look at my daughter, and I just thought, oh, my goodness. In the midst of this, here comes some Jewish Orthodox Jews. And you have to know something. Orthodox Jews don't have anything to do with Christians. And they're coming down the aisles asking us to go in the back and pray with them. That is very unusual. Come back. We need all the help we can get. Let's forget our disagreement for a minute. Would you please come up? And so we have people from our group going into the back praying. I'm telling you, it was. People were crying. You'd hear them screaming. And I had a newspaper, and I'm reading it. My daughter, Corinne, afterwards says to me, Daddy, why were you doing that? I said, I'll never forget. I said, well, honey, I knew that God isn't through with our church. She said, did it never occur to you he doesn't need you to finish what he's going to do with the church? I said, not at the moment. I'm glad you didn't say that. But I had the peace of the Lord. You have to have the peace of the Lord wherever you are. But here's the thing I wanted to illustrate. Years later, not that long ago, my daughter Anna, who was also on the plane, and Anna, who was 9 years old, said to me, she said, Dad, do you remember the story of what had happened on the plane and all? I said, yeah, of course. She said, I've never told you what I was feeling. I said, no, you haven't, baby. And she said, I wasn't afraid either. And I said, why is that? She said, because I watched you. She said, I knew that if you weren't afraid, I have no reason to fear either. And I learned something from my little girl that day that I've brought into my life, and I've always kind of known it, but now I know it for sure. In the midst of chaos, in the midst of confusion, in the midst of fear, there needs to be a calm heart. There needs to be somebody there of faith, somebody who trusts the Lord, no matter what. So when you go through the difficult times, and if everybody's panicking, and everybody's screaming, and everybody's crying, there needs to be a calm heart. So rather than giving into the fear of the moment, which can be a very real fear, a very real fear. I mean, we came down, as we were coming down to make our approach, the waves, you could see the waves were just roiling, and you could see the foam, and it was so bad that we had to go back up. And we ended up going to Canada. They took us to Canada, and we had to wait out the storm. But I'll tell you something, guys, keep this in mind, especially those of us who have influence, especially those of us who are parents. People will look to the calm person. Sometimes they may think you're an idiot. Sometimes they may think that you're foolish, like my daughter. Dad, come on. I mean, no, you need to be an anchor. You need to be the person who's settled. You know, I do not take things lightly. Sometimes people may think that people like me do. I do not. I weigh things through, and I think things through, and I react accordingly. Always in mind one thing. My God is in control. I'm not. I will trust in the one who never fails. I will trust in him. That's what I do. And when things kind of get kind of crazy, I don't get crazy with it. I calm down. We were having a meal at my house several years ago now, and I was eating, and when I took a bite out of I was eating some steak, it got lodged in my throat. I couldn't breathe, and I was just sitting there, and I thought, I'm just thinking, gonna have to do something about this. So I took a drink to try and, you know, wash it down, and I ended up spitting out because I couldn't breathe. So I stood up, and I just take a very casual walk. My son David looks at me and says, Dad, are you okay? And I forgot to go, whatever sign, I can't breathe. So I said, no. He says, are you choking? And I said, so David tries to do this Heimlich thing, and he's throwing me around like a rag doll, so I'll be a bruised corpse. So one of the guys who was there was a police officer at my house. He was on his texting, and he looks up and sees me dying. He puts it down, gets up, moves my son, puts his hand in my chest, pops out the meat. And I breathe. They said, we didn't know there was something wrong with you. And I said, because I have opposite reactions than a lot of people. I don't panic. I go into a calm state. I always do. Even when I'm about to die, I go into a calm state. Why is that? Because panic never helps anybody. It certainly wouldn't help me. And if I was starting to panic, I'm going to use all my oxygen up. So I'm going to walk very slowly. I'm going to say, I'm dying, and somebody can help me, right? Why did I tell you that story? Because he shall keep you in perfect peace if your mind is stayed on the Lord, because you trust in him. Calmness, assurance, awareness was something that Paul had that this Roman man could see. He could respect that. Paul earned his respect. And as Christians, I really think it's important for us not to join with the world in panic every time it's in panic. Take a couple steps back. Look at the situation. Pray and ask God for the peace that passes all understanding and operate under that principle. You will have an impact on people later on because they'll say, when everybody was panicking, you were at peace. Can you tell me why? Because the God of all peace will keep me in perfect peace because my mind has stayed on him. What is the worst thing that could happen to me? I'll be with the Lord. Is that a bad thing? No. Do I want to hasten that moment? No. I want to stay as long as I can. Why? You don't love Jesus? I love him. He'll take me at the right moment. But until then, I want to care for my wife. I want to care for my children. I want to care for my grandchildren. I want to care for my friends. I want to love my church. I want to be faithful until the end. And so I wait on the Lord and hopefully can be a model of people who trust the Lord. That way, when our church panics, they can look up and see someone at the helm who's holding fast and say, no, God is in control. Let's hold on to him because he will take us through any storm we ever find ourselves in. Let's stay true to him. That's how it works.